Blackstone Publishing presents Ghostbusters, the original movie novelizations omnibus by Richard Mueller and Ed Naha. This book is read by Johnny Heller. For Mom and Dad. Chapter 1. How much there is in books that one does not want to know. John Burroughs. It was a bright sunny day in early autumn, one of those days New Yorkers dote on, take pictures of, and point out to their country cousins as an example of the city at its best. The city after summer, after the pavements stop frying. The city not yet locked into the icy streets and frozen dog wastes of winter. A picture postcard day. A day to write home to Cincinnati or Scranton or Tullahoma about. And every New Yorker with an excuse was out of doors, clogging the sidewalks, slowing traffic, frightening the pigeons. Tour buses, hot dog vendors, street musicians, flower sellers. All had noticed an increase in trade. People were more cheerful. There was an excess of happy normalcy in the air. The sun had risen that morning, as it did every morning, by bubbling up out of Long Island Sound, climbing over the Chrysler Building and casting its warmth down on Midtown Manhattan. By dusk, it would be finished and sliding quickly toward the Jersey marshes. If it sent down its warmth anywhere else, New Yorkers were not aware of it and cared less. It was here, and it felt good. That was enough. Two men who particularly reveled in the sunlight that September day were Harlan Boje and Robert Learned Coombs. Boje had once been a jockey until, at the age of 24, he had inexplicably gained 45 pounds and 4 inches in height, which finished forever his dreams of winning the Triple Crown. This had been some 35 years ago, and Boje had been unemployed since. His partner, Coombs, a taciturn Oklahoma Indian, had come to New York to make his fortune as a singer. He had drive, ambition, daring, pizzazz. Everything, in fact, but a voice. And so Harlan Boje and Robert Learned Coombs were now partners in leisure, philosophy, and life. They sat beneath the great jaws of a stone lion guarding the Fifth Avenue entrance to the New York Public Library, passing a bottle of Chateau Plain Rap back and forth and discussing the nature of existence. "Robert, my lad, have you ever been in there?" "In there? In the library? Sure, I guess so, a couple times." "Wonderful things, books, right? But dangerous, exceedingly dangerous, lots of dangerous things in books." Coombs was nonplussed. Once again, Boje had run off with the thread of the conversation.
"Dangerous, you mean, like guys who cut the centers out and hide guns and dope and stuff inside?"
Boje snorted in exasperation.
"I'm speaking of ideas, you melonhead. Dangerous ideas, ideas and philosophies."
He took a long draw on the wine. "Dangerous ideas." Coincidentally, less than 100 feet away, Alice Melvin was thinking exactly the same thing, for an entirely different reason. Like Boje and Coombs, she too had had big dreams, and like them, she had come to New York to make them come true. But fate had once again taken down the road signs and painted out the center line. Instead of becoming a fashion designer, she was, at the age of 29, working in the New York Public Library. Stout and plain, any sort of meaningful social life had eluded her, and she'd become an exile in her own mind and a prisoner of her fantasies. The last man who had gone home with her had left in the morning with her VCR, and she'd given up trying, grimly resigned to a life in the stacks, moving books about, gaining wisdom and greatness through osmosis, hoping to return in the next life as Lonnie Anderson. That is, until she had discovered the incunabula. There were many locked and private collections of books at the main branch, and she'd had keys for some of them, but one day at the main desk, she'd picked up the wrong set of keys by accident. At least she told herself it was an accident. She had then proceeded to try a few doors that had been closed to her. Behind one of them, in a collection of European popular incunabula, she had discovered a book of woodcuts depicting sexual positions and concepts she'd not dreamed existed. They were crude in comparison to better works of both the period and the subject, but they touched a chord deep in Alice Melvin. On that sunny September day, deep in the stacks where no sunlight ever reaches, Alice Melvin was reshelving books, working her cart slowly along the aisles near the card catalog. As she turned over each title, checking the numbers on the spine, she failed to notice the vaguest hint of an odor in the air, a sickly sweetness that seemed to waft at right angles to her path, drifting toward the endless rows of card files. Alice's mind was only half on her job.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.